Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars, Ambush at Corellia, Volume 1 of the Corellian Trilogy by Roger MacBride Allen. All right, Chewie, try it now. Han Solo stuffed the comlink back in his pocket and stepped back a bit from the Millennium Falcon, an anxious look on his face. It ought to work this time, but that was what they had figured the time before, and the time before that. He could see into the Falcon's cockpit viewports from where he stood, and Chewbacca didn't look all that confident either. He saw Chewbacca reach for the lift controls. Han realized that he'd been holding his breath and forced himself to exhale. The Millennium Falcon shifted slightly on her hard stand, then rose slowly into the evening air. Chewie took her up until the landing pads were at Han's eye level and held her there. Han pulled out the comlink again and spoke into it.
That's good, good. Now engage the shields.
The air all around the Falcon seemed to shimmer a bit and then steadied down. Han stepped back just a bit further, not wishing to be all that close when Chewie cut the repulsors.
All right, Chewie. Repulsors off.
The glow of the repulsors dimmed, and the ship dropped abruptly and stopped, suspended in midair, with the landing pads waist high off the ground. Sparks and scintillations flared and flickered here and there on the hard stand as the Falcon's shields shifted under stress.
Good, Han said. Very good.
Suddenly, the sparking grew brighter, fiercer, just under the number two landing pad.
Chewie! Repulsors on! It's gonna...
With a shuddering flash of light, the rear shields blew out. The aft landing pad slammed into the hardstand with a bone-rattling impact that sent Han sprawling. The forward end of the ship hung in midair as the rear half bounced on its jacks back up into the air. Chewie brought the Falcon back down to a gentle landing and cut the repulsors. A moment later, the gangway lowered itself, and Chewie came out, carrying a shield-tuning set. That was not good. After all the years Han had spent with Chewie, he knew better than to let a frustrated Wookiee vent his feelings on a repair job.
Maybe that's not such a good idea, Chewie. Leave it for now. Leia's probably waiting dinner on us anyway.
Amazing how times changed. After all the close calls, all the battles, all the captures and rescues and risks and victories Han had been through, now it came down to getting home to dinner. Han Solo looked up into the evening sky of Coruscant. What was it now? 18 years? 18 years since he had hired on to fly a crazy old man named Ben Kenobi and a kid named Luke Skywalker out of Tatooine. Taking on that job had changed his life forever. And changed the course of galactic history, if you wanted to get grandiose about it. It was 9 years since the defeat of Grand Admiral Thrawn and the Dark Jedi Master. 9 years since the birth of the twins, and just over 7 since Anakin was born.
Captain Solo?
A small, slight, dark-skinned human, a woman, stepped out of the shadows by the hangar entrance. She wore a dark blue uniform that might be one of the Republic Navy branches, but Han was not up to date on what the Navy was wearing these days.
Who might you be?
He asked. She came toward him, smiling calmly. He could see her a bit better now. She was young, maybe 25 standard years at most. Her eyes were set a bit wide apart, and they were a trifle glassy. Her gaze seemed to be a bit off-kilter, as if she were almost but not quite cross-eyed. Her jet-black hair was done up in an elaborate braid coiled on top of her head. She walked toward him with an easy confidence.
Glad to meet you. You can call me Kalenda.
All right, I can call you Kalenda. So what?
Han said.
So I have a job for you.
That brought Han up short. A job? Kalenda shifted her gaze so she was looking almost but not quite in the direction of Chewbacca.
Perhaps we should talk alone.
I don't want to hear anything you have to say that Chewbacca can't hear.
Very well, but perhaps at least the three of us could talk in private?
Fine, Han said. Come on aboard the Falcon.
The probe droid hovered silently up into position, coming up over the wall of the hard stand area, then dropping behind some packing cases to keep out of sight. It was painted matte black and was all but invisible in the deepening shadows. It watched the two humans and the Wookiee head up into the ship. It extended an audio monitor probe and aimed it at the Millennium Falcon. After a moment's hesitation, it moved in closer to the ship.
Kalenda walked up the ramp and into the ship, Han and Chewie following. She reached the top and walked smoothly and confidently toward the lounge. It took Han a moment or two to recall that she had never been aboard the ship before. She should have stopped at the top of the ramp, uncertain of where to go next.
You know everything about me, down to the blueprints of my ship, Han said. You have resources. That doesn't impress me. I'd like to get home to my wife and family. What is it you wanted to see me about?
Your wife and family, Kalenda replied.
The compartment was silent for a moment, and Kalenda stared hard at Han.
I am not threatening your family, but New Republic intelligence would like to make use of them. And you.
New Republic intelligence? What the devil was NRI doing coming to him? If Han was too well-known a person to do smuggling work, he was definitely too well-known to be much use as a spy. Besides which, he didn't much like government spies, no matter who the government was.
You're not improving your survival odds, Han said. Just how are you going to use us?
We know you're going to Corellia.
Oh, you must have a crack team of researchers that checks the news every single day.
Our trip to Corellia is not exactly top secret. If anything, it was what passed for headline news in these quiet times. Leia was part of the Coruscant delegation to a major trade conference on the planet Corellia. It was supposed to be the first step in reopening the whole Corellian sector. The sector, Han's home world, had always been an inward-looking part of the Empire and of the Old Republic before that. By the time Han had left, Corellia had gone past inward-looking to downright secretive and hermetic. Leia had counted it as a triumph just to get the Corellians to host the conference in the first place.
Your wife's attendance has been reported, yes, Kalenda said, but there has been little or no mention of your going along or your children.
What is all this about? My wife is going to a conference on my home world. So what? I'm going and we're taking the kids. Be nice to show them where the old man came from. Is that a crime? Is there something suspicious about that?
No, not yet. But we'd like to make it suspicious. Something's going on in the Corellian sector, something big and something bad. We don't know what. All we do know is that we've sent in a half dozen agents, and none of them has come back. None of them has even managed to report. We want to send in another team, and we want to provide cover for them. That's you. We want you to act as suspiciously as possible. Give yourself a high profile, be visible, draw their attention while we insert our real teams.
What about my family? Would it be dangerous to take my children to Corellia?
Kalenda sighed. It was as if the NRI agent had suddenly vanished and the person behind was appearing.
I wish to the Dark Suns you hadn't asked me that. I honestly don't know. We simply don't know what's going on out there. If avoiding all risk is your only concern, take your children and hide them away in a cave, just to be sure. But is that the way you want to live?
In his old days, his reckless days, Han wouldn't even have thought twice about flying straight into the worst sort of danger. But fatherhood did things to a fellow. However, risk was a part of life, and you had to take a slice of it along with everything else. There were questions of honor and duty as well. If there was trouble back home, in the sector that had given him birth, what sort of man would he be if he could help and did not?
Thank you, Han said. I always appreciate a straight answer. We'll be going to Corellia, and I'll do what I can to act suspiciously. I have a feeling it'll fit in with my natural talents.
After she was gone, Chewie looked toward Han.
I know, he said. But our agents are vanishing on my turf. Is that my people doing that? Should I just turn my back?
Chewie just grunted and turned back toward the cockpit.
He didn't have an answer for that one. Han followed behind him to help him power down the ship. But the Wookiee stopped dead just inside the entrance to the cockpit, and Han nearly walked up his back.
Hey, what are you...
Chewie gestured for silence with a wave of his left hand as he stared straight ahead out the cockpit's viewport. Han saw nothing, but that told him as much as he needed to know. A probe droid, or a living snooper. Chewie had spotted some tiny movement or other. The fact that the snooper was still out there could only mean they were hoping to hear more. Han improvised as best he could.
Oh, yeah. With what she was saying, we're going to have a lot to talk about on the way home. Lots of profits in it for us if we play it right.
That ought to be intriguing enough to keep their friends interested. He and Chewie gestured to each other and keeping their hands from...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.